desktop. No, no, open the desktop. Yes, there you select the desktop.
Select the desktop.
Select the desktop. You select, open the desktop.
You can just minimize the browser also, sir. Just minimize browser.
Minimize whatever the screen of Zoom you are seeing just now. That you minimize that. Minimize that. Oh, you're closing that. That is a problem.
Sorry. No problem. You just minimize Zoom and you can just open the presentation again in the background, sir. Yes, sir.
Yeah, this is again the same. 1467. It's not the file. It's such a small file. It cannot be.
It's 1.2 MB, sir. It's a file, sir.
Now it's okay.
So now it is opening. It is opening. Still, it is not opened up completely.
It's
now,
a single slide only.
It's single. I'm moving here.
Sir, what you can do, first open the presentation, the background, sir.
Okay.
Just minimize room, sir. Mind,
sorry, for another second speaker can go ahead. I will correct it. Sorry, really sorry.
No issue, sir.
Now it's okay?
Yeah, it's okay.
Yes.
Sorry, really sorry. I mean, I felt okay.
No,
so this is on the update on the gastro and hepatic manifestation. But I mean, here, the gastro part, I'm going to present less. The COVID-19 patient, whenever we are seeing in the, either in the ward or in the ICU, mostly they will call us an opinion from the gastroenterologist or hepatologist. There will be a rise in liver enzymes. So initially, last year, there was no much idea about why the liver enzymes are increasing in COVID patients, because it might be due to other etiology. But now we have enough knowledge about whatever we acquired in the last 1 year about the COVID-19. So we know SARS-CoV-2, the viral particle will attach on the ACE2 receptor in the respiratory system. That is the entry point. That's why it is causing the cytokine storm. The same ACE2 inhibitor, ACE2 receptor, it is there in the colonic mucosa. And the same ACE2 receptor in the liver cholangiocyte as well as the hepatocyte, that all the cells of the liver. So once the viral particle, not only in the respiratory system, if it attach with this colonic or in the liver hepatocyte, there will be the organ-related specific manifestation. They will get anorexia, nausea, vomiting, and diarrhea. Same way in the liver, it will cause rise in the liver enzymes. That's why the liver function test, whenever we are going to do in a COVID-positive patient, there will be the rise. There is a direct viral particle induced. So is it the only reason for the rise in the liver enzyme? This I explained. The viral particle directly goes and attach with the ACE2 receptor in the liver, hepatocytes and cholangiocyte increasing, that damaging the cells. Apart from that, overall, the systemic inflammatory response syndrome, whether this virus or any virus related or the bacterial induced SIRS will cause its own manifestation in the liver. That also will cause rise in the liver enzymes. Then some of the drugs we are using to the COVID-19 positive patient, we know the remdesivir. Nowadays the popular word, remdesivir and the tocilizumab. These kind of the drugs can also have the hepatotoxic effect. If we are going to give this medication, we have to be very careful whether the patient already have the any form of liver disease. For example, alcohol-induced liver disease, or they have the fatty liver, or if they have the hepatitis B or C virus-related liver disease. These drugs, remdesivir or tocilizumab, that drugs per se will cause act as a hepatotoxic agent. Apart from that, there is a cardiogenic shock because of the cardiac myocarditis, the virus induced. That will cause overall low blood pressure, So that will cause ischemic hepatitis. So in a COVID-19 positive patient, liver function test is the one of the important test. If the test shows abnormality, we have to think it might be either direct virus induced or CIRS induced, or by giving a treatment, that treatment induced, or overall if there is a cardiogenic shock. What are the liver and liver function tests? You have the bilirubin, AGOT, AGPT, alkaline phosphatase, GGT, etc. So which parameters are very important? This is the data based on the studies. It shows most common liver enzyme rise is SGOT or AST. So that is common. Second, if albumin of the particular patient, if it is a low, it acts as a poor prognostic indicator. And if the prothrombin time, PT, if it goes high, it also indicates the poor outcome. So liver function test abnormality wise, we can slightly predict outcome of the patients. How now we know IL-6 increase or ferritin level high, this all indicates the patient's poor outcome. Similarly, if the same patient have very low serum albumin or the rise in prothrombin time, that patient we have to consider is a severe COVID-19 pneumonia. So the drugs, I told nowadays, remdesivir is used in and out, and also the tocilizumab, even though it is costly, black market, there is a huge sale, but we have to know which patient we have to utilize the drug properly. If the already the patient have any form of chronic liver disease, so how to identify? All the patient has to undergo one basic ultrasonogram of abdomen. If the ultrasonogram of the abdomen, COVID-19 positive patient shows underlying chronic liver disease, coarse liver or cirrhosis, we have to avoid the particular drug. Otherwise, there are enough reports are there. The drug per se will cause acute liver failure in the COVID-19 patients. But what about the paracetamol? Paracetamol we can use. There is no much evidence for causing acute liver failure in COVID-19 patient. Similarly, other medication which earlier the previous prophylaxis we have used, the hydroxychloroquine and azithromycin, there is no much data for about acute liver failure. What about the chronic hepatitis B and the chronic hepatitis C? Chronic hepatitis B is one of the common disease in our country. Not only in our country, all developing countries, this hepatitis B virus and hepatitis C virus are common, but due to the good drug availability, hepatitis C is now in our country under control. But hepatitis B virus still is challenging. We will identify HBsAg positive either before doing the pre-op work or the antenatal mothers. So how to treat if hepatitis C virus is positive? This slide is a very important because hepatitis C virus, as I already told, nowadays cure is possible. That means if we are diagnosing hepatitis C virus positive, 4 years ago, there is no much good treatment for that virus. And most of the hepatitis C virus patient, over the period of time, they will go for cirrhosis or liver cancer, and slowly they will die. But nowadays, hepatitis C virus, very good drugs are available. There is a single dose, daily one tablet for 3 months. The name of the drug called Velpatasvir. Once it comes to the market nowadays, almost all, it shows 99% of cure rate. So the velpatasvir drug now is doing wonder job. So the hepatitis C, even if you are diagnosing virus, we can completely cure. So what is the important with the COVID-19 patient? This velpatasvir drug also act against the COVID-19 virus, SARS-CoV-2. So it has been very clearly mentioned nowadays, there is a more chances irrationally, if you are going to use the velpatasvir drug, there is a possibility of the drug resistance. Example, if a patient have hepatitis C virus, also if they have COVID-19, before to start the velpatasvir, we have to wait for the clearance of the COVID-19 virus. Once 2 weeks later or 3 weeks later, once COVID-related symptoms subsides, we have to repeat that RT-PCR for COVID, make confirm about that the virus is cleared from our body, then only we have to start the velpatasvir drug to clear hepatitis C virus. So in a patient with COVID-19 positive, we should not start velpatasvir when the patient is suffering by COVID-19. We have to wait once the clearance confirmation, after that only we have to give. But in if the patient doesn't have COVID-19 virus, that time we can give the velpatasvir drug once a day for 3 months. Suppose if the patient already on treatment with for hepatitis C virus, in case if they get COVID-19, what to do? The good message here, the chance of getting that COVID-19 virus, those who are already on hepatitis C virus therapy are very less, very few case reports worldwide published. So we no need to worry. In case if they on treatment, if they get a virus, that we should not stop the velpatasvir. That means hepatitis C virus therapy, the duration of therapy is 90 days. We have to complete the full course of the velpatasvir. What about the hepatitis B virus? This, as I already mentioned, it is more common in our country. If the patient is already on treatment for hepatitis B virus, there are good drugs are available, but we know the drugs for hepatitis B virus is just to control the viral load or viral replication. It will not give cure to the patient. So we have to continue the drug, even though COVID positive or COVID negative, if we are identifying a patient with the hepatitis B association, we have to start the hepatitis B virus therapy. We should not wait for the COVID virus clearance. So this is the two difference between hepatitis C virus and B virus. C virus, we have to wait for COVID virus clearance, then we have to start, but B virus, we have to continue. Third, this is common in the females, autoimmune hepatitis. Here, if the patient ANA will be the positive, the treatment for autoimmune hepatitis is the steroid. So the good message here, your liver patients with already on steroid, in case if they get the COVID virus, what about the outcome? So most of the guidelines and the literature shows we have to continue the steroid therapy. Earlier, last year, once the COVID virus related the articles comes out, that time there was a inhibition by giving steroid, whether the viral, that autoimmune related patient giving the steroid more and more, whether it will worsen the patient disease. But now it's unproven. Steroid acts as the therapeutic, main therapeutic role in the SARS-CoV infection. So autoimmune hepatitis patient, we have to continue the therapy. Always the autoimmune hepatitis patient will be on the other supportive medication like azathioprine, sometime mycophenolate mofetil. So that dosage we have to reduce if the patient have COVID positive. non-alcoholic fatty liver disease. It is nowadays more common in our country. The teetotalers are coming, or the ladies they are showing will coming for menstrual checkup. We are seeing ultrasonogram shows the fatty liver. This non-alcoholic fatty liver disease is the component of the metabolic syndrome. We know metabolic syndrome is the five component: dyslipidemia, obesity, and the hypertension, hypothyroidism. So mostly the patient will develop the cardiac complications. But now these are non-alcoholic fatty liver disease also one of the component of the metabolic syndrome. We know whatever the risk factor, either diabetes, hypertension, dyslipidemia, obesity, all these will cause the poor outcome in a COVID positive patient. So if we are identifying non-alcoholic fatty liver disease, we have to try to educate, because outcome of that patient with the COVID-19 will be poor. This is called cirrhosis. ESLD means end stage liver disease. So we know there are two component of the cirrhosis. One is the compensated cirrhosis. That means patient will be fine. They will not have any symptom, but ultrasonogram or other test will show they have a cirrhosis. Another component of the cirrhosis is the decompensation. They will have more and more symptoms. They will have a jaundice. They will have the pedal edema, ascites, sometimes GI bleed, blood vomiting due to cirrhosis, altered sensorium, that all. So this component, all the decompensated chronic liver disease have more poor outcome with COVID-19. So if you see the COVID virus, it is more risk in the cirrhosis. This nowadays we are seeing in our day-to-day practice. Already a patient will have a end stage liver disease, suddenly will get the COVID-19 virus, and they will get admission in the COVID ward or COVID ICU, and most of them will deteriorate over the period of time because their immunity level will be already poor, and the complications, it will worsen. And because cirrhosis means not only the one organ disease, it will affect multiple level organs: cirrhotic cardiomyopathy, hepatopulmonary syndrome, cirrhotic osteoporosis. So many the component of the cirrhosis, the outcome will be very poor. So compensated cirrhosis patient, better we have to use the telemedicine wise. We have to communicate with them all the consultation. We should not tell the patient come to the hospital. In a decompensated chronic liver disease patient, only if they suffer by one of the major symptoms, they can come to the hospital. So that's the main thing. And finally, I'm coming to the liver transplantation. So when we have to suggest a liver transplant in COVID patients? Unfortunately, last year, once the COVID comes, almost all centers across the world, they stopped the liver transplant program, whether it is a deceased donor or living donor. Our India, mostly it depends on living donor liver transplant. That means one of the close family member will come forward to donate part of the liver to the patient. So donor risk we have to consider. So temporarily, all over the world, they withhold the elective surgery. But nowadays, there are several guidelines from the International Society and the National Society how safe we are to do the liver transplantation. In Chennai, we have done the almost now 1 year, 83 liver transplantation. Out of these deceased donor, mean cadaver donor, only 2, remaining all 81 are living donor liver transplant. So here, if you look into that, already as per the government guideline, in the pandemic time, we should not take any elective surgery. Only emergency surgery only we have to consider. What are the emergencies in liver transplant? Acute liver failure. If you are not going to do liver transplant, the concerned individual will die within 72 hours. Acute on chronic liver disease, and there is a score called MELD score for to assess the liver disease severity and liver cancer. So these four indications, the patient will not survive for more than 30 days if we are not doing liver transplant. So the centers across the world has clearly following this instruction. So no more elective liver transplantation. Those who are too sick, those who can't survive, that time you have to do surgery. And we know it is a big teamwork because so many departments will involve the, so that time the preoperative COVID screening is very important tool. These are all the in our center we are following. In nutshell, we can say 2 weeks prior to the transplant, say we have to isolate both the donor and the patient. And we have to do that 2 times COVID RT-PCR. And before the day of surgery, 1 day prior to the surgery, we have to do the CT scan for chest to assess the COROT score. Then we have to take. So by God's grace, successfully, we have done the, our transplant success in the COVID time, 95%. I have to thank for the, all my team peoples. So thank you. Thank you so much for the kind listening.
Thank you, sir, for a wonderful talk, sir. Any questions from the panelists, sir?
Good evening, Joy, sir. That's a fantastic presentation. Thank you for the data. I think that's what we are seeing nowadays. This is the studio, my gastro consultant, Jambal Hospital. Most of the time, what we experience regarding the gastro updates, I was saying, they present to us with diarrhea nowadays, and GI symptoms only just diarrhea presentation to feeding, cough or fever is coming to us in almost 20% of the cases. For every 10 patients we see in OP, one of the patients is coming and telling mild diarrhea, like, you know, 2 to 3 episodes of semi-solid stool, some tiredness, unable to eat. These patients, when we follow up, they develop some respiratory system symptoms like after 7 to 10 days, and they test COVID positive. And when it comes to liver in OP, as a general gastro practice, we pick up mild elevation of GGT and ALP, even normal patients. And especially in cirrhosis patients, in one of my own patients, I've seen worsening of this alkaline phosphatase and GGT from normal level to 600 to 800 without any other symptom. And her husband was COVID positive, and when we took RT-PCR for her, it turned out to be positive without any respiratory symptoms at all. So we are seeing this atypical presentation nowadays. We still don't have the data for the new variant. But as I was saying, this is something new. Maybe in next presentation, we'll be able to tell exactly what our hospital has gone through and how much of our patients are experiencing with GI and liver manifestations.
Thank you. Dr. Vikas, sir, in today's scenario, when the patient is not getting beds at hospital, they're at home only, for the gastro manifestations, what should we do? What is your advice for them?
I think... Vishnu should answer that question from the gastro point of view.
When it's just diarrhea and these patients are not going to get sick, if they are vaccinated and they are less than 60, the best thing is to do home monitoring. We ask them to buy a pulse oximeter and monitor the saturation at home only. Only if they become extremely sick or they develop a respiratory system symptoms, then we ask them to come and get admitted and evaluated. And some of the tests which we do, like interleukin-6, CRP, and D-dimer and ferritin, this we can do even on OP basis. So in our hospital, we suggest only home quarantine. We don't recommend admission for them. And when it comes to elective procedures, we screen all the patients for CT, chest, and RT-PCR. When we do colonoscopy and sigmoidoscopy, we generally do not screen, but we know that the virus is excreted in stool for almost 5 weeks after infection. So we have to be careful. Now we know that it's aerosol generating. It's an airborne disease, so you just have to be careful. So as far as possible, patients who have lesser symptoms, just only GI symptoms, give them symptomatic treatment, try not to target the virus, advise them home quarantine. We don't admit them, unless otherwise the diarrhea is like severe dehydrating type of diarrhea, which we do not see. we just see a mild diarrhea most often because it's usually a mild colitis.
I have one question. Hello.
Yeah.
I am audible?
Yes, sir.
Okay. I have one question from Dr. Joy. Hello.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. So, we are treating patients in our world. Your presentation was excellent. Let me first tell this, that eye-opener rather. But I have one question regarding use of remdesivir. What SGOT and SGBT level should be there when starting this remdesivir?
Yeah.
Because the enzymes are quite high in COVID-19 cases.
Yeah. So we have to do the basic ultrasonogram, sir, actually, whenever before to start the COVID patient, because that is a technically difficult, because keeping the ultrasonogram, machine in the COVID ward or COVID ICU, it is a challenging. But there are provision in hospitals. They will keep their own separate ultrasonogram machine in the COVID only to use it for the COVID patients. So the radiologist will go with the full PPE and they will do. Otherwise, looking into that, their past records, if they have the patient, if they have COVID positive patient, if they have the previous one or the record shows, he have the already existing liver disease or the ultrasonogram shows the chronic cirrhosis and the splenomegaly, or they have the GI bleed or some of the evidence, something if we get it, or if the history wise, if they get it from the family member, then we have to be double cautious before to use the remdesivir. If all the history wise, nothing, no, and the patient clinically also, there is no peripheral signs of chronic liver disease. So like a pedal edema and other things, that all we have to consider before to start the remdesivir. Because the remdesivir nowadays, most of the peripheral center, they are using in and out, but there are several reports has come out. The remdesivir per se, because the acute, because the liver enzymes. So one more practical guidance I can give, we have to see the serial LFT. If the patients have the day one admission LFT and the day two, or suppose we have 2-3 LFT with the patients, that time, if there is a constant, there is no, it's not going very high, INR or albumin going very low, and the stable means we can slightly, we can start the therapy with the with confidently. If there is a liver enzymes are going high and the INR is going high, that time by starting the therapy, it will worsen the scenario also.
Dr. Joy, I have a question for you, if I may ask with the permission of the panelists.
Sir,
for mild and moderate disease, there is a, all the physicians, when they are doing teleconsultations and providing the care at home, they are advising flavipiridine. So what do you think it's like, flavipiravir, and what is this role, whether we can do go ahead without doing a basic LFT? Because I read, because the day one dose is very high, almost 16 tablets of 800 milligrams. So 400 to 800 milligrams. So what is your take on that, sir?
So before to give whatever the type, because like remdesivir, there are the so many other drugs are there. Before to give the patient, even though at home care, they are going to treat it other things. As we are checking that, as requesting, do the CRP or IL-6, ferritin. Same way, we have to ask they do the liver function test also. If the LFT is fine and if there is a mild rise, not more than the, the double the time of the upper limit of the normal, that time we can give. But whatever the drugs, most of the drugs are not yet, scientifically approved. So we have to be very careful. If it is really scientifically approved, whatever the limited drugs, we have to use correctly to the ideal patient.
Yes. Thank you, sir.
Any more questions from the panel? Saraf, sir? Thank you, sir, for a wonderful talk. Dr. Vishnu, do you want to add anything extra or shall we move to the next?
I think the gastro side is only less. As far as I said, it's only a minimal diarrhea presentation. So I think I don't think there is anything more to add. Saraf detailedly told everything. You can move on to the next presentation. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you. Thanks a lot, sir. Now I request our neuro faculty, Dr. Vikas Agarwal, BM Neuro, PDF Epilepsy, Senior Consultant Neurologist from Glen Eglis, to talk on neurology in COVID-19 pandemic. Dr. Vikas, sir.
Just let me screen share first.
Yes.
Has it come?
Yeah, please.
Yes, sir.
Is it full screen?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Thank you, Dr. Samsul Huda and Indian Orthopedic Association and the Bihar chapter and OrthoLite TV for giving this opportunity to discuss some facts that how we are practicing neurology. And neurology has always been a laid back subject 20 years back. But now over the last 20 years, I think neurology has seen a sea change in practice and everything, whether it is Parkinson's disease or whether it is stroke or whether it is epilepsy surgeries. So our center, we are quite active. I am the program in charge for the DBS program and we do a lot of epilepsy surgeries. So I'll just try to show you some things and facts, what is how neurology practice has changed. So going ahead, I just went to the dashboard of WHO and this is what is the current situation on May 5th, 2021. And you can see that almost 153 crores, 95 lakhs, 4,049 cases of confirmed cases. And we have more than 3 crores, 22 lakhs death. So this is quite alarming right now. And this is the Indian scenario. And as on May 5th in WHO dashboard, I don't know how much correctly this is there, but obviously in our country, we have many more cases which are underreported or which are at home or which are going without testing. So we know very well, and Dr. Joy sir has already spoken about the SARS-CoV-2 and relation to angiotensin converting enzyme 2 receptor. And it is the spike protein which helps, which binds to the receptor and helps into the entry into the virus. And there is this transmembrane serine protease 2, TMPRSS2, which actually cleaves this spike protein and it helps the virus to attach and entry into the cell. So the same way the virus is entering into the liver, and I mean it was discussed the same way it is discussed in the pulmonology, in neurology also the virus has got its own way to reach, either through a hematogenous spread or through there is a lymphogenous through the nasal route there is a spread to the brain. Now it triggers a very bad cytokine storm in few patients in susceptible individuals, which definitely cause multi-organ dysfunction, and that is where the concern is, because we are losing many of these patients, unable to treat them at an early time. Now, if you see the symptoms in general of SARS-CoV-2, and over the last one and a half years of our experience, we know that fever and cough are the most common symptoms. But in present situation, as far as neurology is concerned, is it true? I started questioning myself, and we all now agree in our neurology panel that we see a lot of neurology symptoms without patient having any fever or cough. And that is something which is very alarming. And Dr. Vishnu mentioned about the diarrhea as a presentation and nausea, vomiting and fatigue. So these are common symptoms which we usually don't miss. But when it comes to neurological illness, their symptoms can be different, as you will see in the subsequent slide. And we know about these characteristic laboratory findings like lymphopenia, thrombocytopenia, leukopenia, and the CT chest finding. One year back, when we were discussing our protocols for stroke in our hospital, we were largely depending on the CT findings. And we used to say CORAD is a very good way to say that the patient may have a high chance of SARS-CoV-2. But now that belief is also shaken, because we are seeing many cases where the chest may be normal, but they are presenting with stroke and COVID infection. So that is a point which we need to keep in mind. We cannot depend on the CT findings alone to classify or stratify these patients. So like CORAD 5, we were advising them to admit in COVID ICU, whereas CORAD 2 or 3, we were keeping in neuro ICU in the stroke critical care unit. But now we go more with the other factors and we try to take help of our ID colleagues more often and then try to stratify the cases. Now, what is the issue? First of all, is there a neurological involvement isolated in COVID-19? Yes, I think so. We are seeing more number of stroke patients. We are seeing other manifestations. And which neuro axis is involved? So almost all, the central nervous system, the peripheral nervous system, the muscles, everything is involved now. And we know it very clearly now. And the larger question is, are the outcomes different in COVID-19 patients? So patients who are non-COVID and having stroke or other acute neurological illness, are their outcome different from patients who are infected with COVID-19 virus? And whether this virus itself has got a pathogenicity in producing stroke or other acute neurological manifestation? That is a larger question which we have to answer. Now, in terms of neurological manifestations, if you can see, there are a lot of symptoms which has been said. So right from the hemorrhagic encephalopathy, which COVID encephalopathy, which can be a very serious form of the presentation, we are seeing patients, we are just presenting with a single seizure or a new onset seizure. Anosmia, we know, all of us know, complete to severe anosmia, neuropsychiatric manifestations, headache, tremors, abnormal movement, Guillain-Barré syndrome or GBS. That's very interesting now. We are seeing Guillain-Barré syndrome more now, and GBS in the last couple of 1 month, 2 months, we have seen almost 4 or 5 GBS cases where the presentation was very atypical and the motor power loss or the weakness was not much. So as orthopedicians, you may encounter patients who may come with weakness to you, and then they may have very mild weakness and many much more sensory symptoms. So COVID-19 triggered GBS, that is also is something which we have to keep in our mind. Not nevertheless to mention the myalgia and the myelitis. So as I was just telling, the routes of spread from the cribriform plate to the olfactory pathway, it can spread to the brain. It can directly spread from the lungs to the hematogenous pathway to the brain. And then in the end stage, it may cause a loss of voluntary control of breathing. So, you know, the meme, which is very certain, you know, so PCR, CRP, and then CPR. So it's something like that. The stages in which a COVID encephalopathy can really progress. Now, if you see the MRI findings in a COVID-19 patients, they can be very, very varied. So if you see this particular picture, you have a very extensive involvement here of bihemispheric T2-weighted hyperintensities, which is nothing but the involvement of the gray matter, along with a lot of cerebral swelling and edema, which is happening as we see in any kind of viral encephalitis. And it is quite extensive. It is not a particular lobe-specific encephalitis. Like in herpes simplex virus, we see a very predominant prediction to temporal lobes. Here, we don't see a picture like that. We see a very varied kind of picture. It can be as subtle as in these MRI films you can see, or it can be much more subtle, or in fact, you can have an MRI which can even be completely normal. So that is the point. Now, if you look into the data of the initial neurological manifestations, and if you look at the original Wuhan data, where it was 214 patients, almost more common in patients, it was found that very severe disease patients, patients who have severe COVID-19 infections, almost 45% of them have some form of the neurological manifestations. And COVID encephalopathy and seizures were on the top on the charts. But all the whole system is involved. So in central nervous system, we get mind headache. So in my clinic nowadays, chronic migraine in any neurology practice is very common. But a new onset migraine in a person who has never had migraine in his life, we should always raise an alarm for a COVID-19 infection. And I'm regularly picking up cases who are just presenting with severe intractable headache, not responding to any kind of analgesia, and they're landing up in clinics. And then when we are checking SpO2 levels, it can be just a hypoxia related severe headache. And last week also I picked up 2 cases. So it is now one of the manifestations which you should not miss. Acute cerebral events, anyway, I will be talking about ataxia, seizures, and impaired consciousness. This is itself is very common. When it comes to peripheral nervous system manifestations, we all know about taste, smell, and vision. But what attention I want to bring to this esteemed crowd is that about Bell's palsy and Guillain-Barré syndrome. So we are seeing more number of patients who are presenting with isolated non-diabetic Bell's and patients who have Guillain-Barré syndrome, which is quite atypical. These cases, we should definitely test them for a COVID-19 infection. They may not have fever, they may not have cough, they may not have other manifestations. They may just present with a Bell's palsy or a Guillain-Barré syndrome. And we definitely have to think. It could be that they may had a milder infection. As you know, in Guillain-Barré, usually the virus infection is 2 to 3 weeks prior to the neurological manifestation. So they may have a minor viral infection, which could be a COVID infection, and then they are presenting with a Guillain-Barré syndrome or a Bell's palsy. Skeletal muscular involvement. So one important note in this is that muscular pain or myalgia. Now, a common clinical scenario which we have to understand is that after a vaccine, you may have a severe myalgia, whether it is Covishield or Covaxin, and that can last for up to 48 to 72 hours. But any myalgia in a patient who has a vaccine, and because the vaccine duration, there is a gray zone of 2 weeks, the patient may be getting an active infection when he was vaccinated. So we should check beyond 72 hours. We should go ahead and check for CPK levels and look for whether there is any evidence of active COVID-19 infection. Any myalgia lasting more than 72 hours after a COVID-19 vaccination, we should look for an active infection or a myositis. There is also reports of myoglobinuria. So a very significant amount of muscle damage can happen either due to COVID-19 infection, or there may be a mild CPK rise while in vaccination also. But post-vaccination myalgia is usually mild and it usually settles down within 72 hours. That is a point which we have to keep in our mind. So impaired consciousness can be of various levels. It can be somnolence, it can be stupor, it can be coma, confusion, and delirium. So there can be various levels of presentation. A patient may be just mildly confused. That itself could be a presentation of a COVID encephalopathy to a patient who has come in a deep coma. So there is a various levels of presentation, various varied MRI pictures, which I showed from completely severe MRI scans to a very normal MRI scan, from mild headaches to a severe acute migraine to a Bell's palsy and GBS. So anything atypical now, so the dictum is anything atypical, anything out of the way, a neurological presentation, please check for COVID-19 infection because that could be the etiology of that particular symptom. Now, coming to the acute cerebrovascular events. So we know that we have two types of stroke. One is the ischemic and intracranial hemorrhage. And neurological manifestations per se are very much common. And the stroke and the type of stroke which we see can be both either ischemic or hemorrhagic. Now, we are patients of mild, moderate to severe disease may need anticoagulation. And that itself can be predispose the patient to a higher risk of hemorrhagic stroke. But now the new consensus, it is very clear that COVID-19 pandemic, the stroke risk is slightly higher, especially in patients who have comorbidities like diabetes, hypertension, obesity, COPD, and other diseases. So Indian Stroke Association has come up with a guideline which was published last year. This has not been updated till now, but overall, it tells us how to achieve with an acute stroke patient. So in a non-COVID scenario, we were in a liberty to go ahead with an MRI, a diffusion-weighted MRI, immediately if it is available, and look for the extent of the stroke. But now in this situation, it is not possible. So a CT scan brain is very well enough to plan for a thrombolytic therapy if the patient has come in an acute stroke emergency within the window period. So CT chest, when we are doing in a suspected case of COVID, we always do a CT brain also together. And if the patient is in window period, and then we follow the protocol. So a hospital, which is not a corporate hospital, they can have their own protocol. Most of the middle order hospitals, they may have a CT scan, and that may be enough for them to triage these acute stroke patients. So how to treat them? The protocols are almost the same like the non-COVID scenario. But the point is that in acute stroke patients who comes in window, we have to stratify the risk because they may be at a higher risk of thrombolytic related bleed. So whether we are using a tissue plasminogen activator, which is Actilase or Tenecteplase, in both these drugs, there may be a slightly higher risk of bleeding if there is a very large stroke or especially in a large vessel stroke. So a middle order hospital, as soon as a patient suspected of stroke comes within a window period, along with a CT chest, we should do a CT brain immediately. Second point is that usually in most of the hospital, there is a dedicated or a CT scan which is screening the COVID patients or which is used separately for the screening of the COVID patients. So that is something which has to be employed if it is available. If not, then standard protocols for COVID should be followed and the patient should be immediately referred to a government setup or to a higher setup where it is available without wasting the time. Because if we are delaying the referral in an acute stroke patient who is in window, then we may be medico-legally liable. So that is one point which we have to keep in mind. If our hospital has the capability of treating the acute stroke patient, even though we do not have bed and the patient has come in the window period, we can still go ahead with the CT brain and CT chest, and we can thrombolize the patient in emergency and then tell the patient to refer to a higher center. Because if we refer and if we have the facility of thrombolysis and we are referring the patient, then by the time the patient reaches another hospital, he may come out of the window period and he may lose the window. So that is one point which we can keep in mind. But many times practically, it may not be possible. We try to do to stick to this protocol as much as possible. We have referred patients after thrombolysis in our emergency to government hospitals or to other centers where the bed availability is there if this COVID suspicion is high. That is one point which we have to understand. Now, there was another paper which has come in India which shows the data. And you see, this is a AIIMS data. So what has changed now? Last year, when the COVID infection came, in fact, if you see the AIIMS data in the first column, pre-COVID, there were 29 acute strokes per week they were getting. But post-COVID, during the COVID period, they were getting only 8. And pre-COVID, the rate of thrombolysis was around 6 to 7 per week. But post-COVID, during the COVID period, it is only 1. So actually, the data was quite shocking because it showed that there was a reduction in the number of stroke patients coming to the emergency. There was reduction in the IV thrombolysis up to 40 to 50%. Why this was happening? This is what was actually a referral bias. What was happening last year is that because of the fear, many of the minor stroke patients, they were not attending the emergencies thinking that there could be a possibility of a COVID thing. So we were getting only patients who are in a larger strokes or who are large vessel occlusions. So basically the patients attending to the emergency per se in mild to moderate strokes was very less. And that is why there was a dip in the stroke cases. But if you see the newer data, which has come very recently, what it has shown, in this paper, which was by Srivastava et al., they have seen almost 41,000 cases, among which 1,143 were COVID-related acute stroke. What they found was that Asians are slightly more predisposed to COVID and acute stroke, maybe because of the related comorbidities. One of the commonest comorbidity they may have is diabetes. And we all know very well diabetes, hypertension per se can be a risk factor of stroke. Second thing, what now it is happening as compared to the last year, the thrombolysis rate has become the same. The thrombectomy rate also has become the same, which is the interventional catheter-based thrombectomy. Mechanical thrombectomy. So now the thrombolysis rate, which was less last year, has almost normalized to the pre-COVID period. But what has happened is that the duration these treatments are given to the patient, so the door to needle time or the CT time, that has reduced, that has become prolonged. So thrombolysis time for a 46 minute, that is from the patient entry to the emergency till the patient received the injection, which was around 45 minutes usually, has gone up to 1 hour. This is obviously, we can understand it is because of the patient's, protective measures have to be, COVID protocols have to be followed. But now, nonetheless, Asians are much more predisposed to the acute stroke, and the COVID-related acute stroke have become much common. But the treatment protocols should remain the same, and we should thrombolize the patient as much as possible. And this chart clearly shows the percentage is almost like 4.9% in Asians now in total COVID infections with acute ischemic stroke. Now, this is a little data which we saw last year in our hospital when we analyzed 3 months data. We actually had, and compared with 2019 data, we actually had an initial increased trend of the strokes. So from 17% to 32%. So which is now very well valid now, as I showed in the previous paper, which I just presented. So what about epilepsy? So this was a word about stroke. One common thing about stroke before I move to epilepsy is that common question whether we should stop our anticoagulation or antiplatelet medicine. So there was an initial fear and confusion last year that we should stop the anticoagulation because there can be injection site hematoma or many other complications. But now a general practical guideline is we do not stop any anticoagulation or any medication of an acute stroke or a chronic stroke patient who has come with a recurrent stroke or a new neurological problem or any other different problem. They can go for vaccination safely with the current dosage of medications which they are telling, obviously with under the guidance of their treating doctor. Coming to epilepsy, one quick word. There is no evidence of at present that COVID-19 reduces the seizure threshold, but COVID can present per se as seizures or a new onset seizure, which may be because of encephalopathy or hypoxia. What is required for epilepsy is that we have to treat them as much as home as possible. So in this regard, intranasal midazolam. So there is a spray called as Midazip or Inset, which is usually all of our epilepsy patients, we usually tell them to keep that at home. So for a minor seizure, one or two seizures, or even for a generalized seizures, this can be employed directly at home. This is something which we encourage now so that the patients give the care at home and do not struggle to get the ambulances or the other support staff, which may be very difficult to get, and by the time patient is not treated at all. Second, there should be no panic with epilepsy because we know that any seizure which lasts only for 2 minutes and we should not panic. Second thing is that patients should keep a good stock of their anti-epileptic medicines. Many it is seen now that the anti-epileptic drugs are getting out of the stock or the patient is not able to take the medicine and they are coming with breakthrough seizures. So this is one simple point that to keep additional stock of medicines beforehand because there may be lockdown and other issues which may cause a lack of supply of the medicines. Now, multiple sclerosis and demyelinating disorders, one important point, this is very similar to the immunotherapy which is given to the post-renal transplant patients. So these patients with multiple sclerosis, they may have many immunomodulators or disease-modifying therapy. But what is required is that we try to avoid giving higher grades of demyelinating and immunomodulating therapy. If we can prolong it, it is better because giving these, there may be a higher risk of infections in these patients and these patients need to be hospitalized. So there is a risk of immunocompromised state. So until unless absolutely required, we have to weigh one case versus the other case risk-benefit ratio or for an individual case. And there cannot be a standard guideline for this. Now, I'll just finish two or three slides with a Parkinson's disease. I'm a Parkinson's expert and we have done in the COVID period at least two or three DBAs now, but we are trying to avoid doing any deep brain stimulation right now. We did one last month, but because of this COVID situation, it may be difficult to program this patient subsequent after the DBS. So we are basically avoiding. One thing which was seen very clearly is that because of the COVID-19 infection scenario and because of the lockdown, there is an increase in the non-motor symptoms like anxiety and fatigue and then constipation and so many other kind of mood disorders which are happening, sleep disorders. Dr. Siddhika here maybe will be highlighting it a bit more in her talk. So this is one paper which came of 64 cases, which was between June to September 2020. And it was found that almost 50% of Parkinson's patients who are at home has shown worsening in their symptoms. Either it is a stiffness or rigidity. And as orthopedicians, you may be seeing some of these Parkinson's patients who may be your post-knee replacement patients or hip replacement patients. There is a clinical worsening in this patient, and it is well known now. What is required is more exercised, home-based exercise treatment, because exercise, lack of exercise and the psychological stress of the lockdown has actually triggered more amount of symptoms in Parkinson patients. So the new normal is maybe a teleconsultation, and we already, the orthopedic associations, you just now we discussed about keeping social distancing and wearing masks. Sir has lucidly told about it, the need for it. And we should not over-investigate. So to be very honest, sometimes we may be, neurology is a field where we may be sometimes very confused about the diagnosis and we may be over-investigating. But in the present scenario, it is not the case. we should judiciously use the investigations and try to rely more on our clinical and our clinical acumen and our experience. So this is what has happened over the last 1 year. There was a fear zone. Because of the fear zone, even the mild to moderate strokes were not coming to the hospital, and the stroke rates and thrombolysis rates have fallen down. Then there was a learning zone. And now we know the disease, we are knowing better how to tackle with this virus. And now we are maybe in the growth zone. So we know what has to be done. And maybe across all specialties, there is a more consensus. And with a human approach, we can help our patients who definitely need us in these difficult times. Thank you so much for giving me this opportunity.
Hello. I have one question to be asked from Vikas, Dr. Vikas.
Yes, sir.
Is there any special drug in Parkinson's disease with COVID-19? Because we know that there is muscle rigidity and there is very poor cuff reflex. So yes. How to treat such type of cases?
Sir, so if you talk about new drugs in Parkinson's disease treatment, there is one drug which has become more popular in the last 1 year, 1-2 years maybe, is zafinamide, which is, you know, Zafinact. Now, the point is, sir, still the best drug, if you are treating with a pure Parkinson's disease patient and you're not treating Parkinson's plus disorder, where they may have other complications, the best drug is levodopa or Sindopa plus, which we all know. You know, what may be required if you have a patient with Parkinson's who has worsened and comes to your clinic, what may be required is to hike up the levodopa dose a bit. Suppose the patient is taking half tablet or four times a day or one tablet four times a day, you can give the first and third dose one and a half or two like that. So most of the time, that strategy helps for this patient. As per relation to COVID-19, there is no specific drug indications or guidelines to my knowledge. What I feel is that especially the agonistic drugs we have to avoid. Why the reason for that? Like the agonist drug is like pramipexole or ropinirole. These are the two drugs which we commonly use in Indian scenario. The reason for that is that those drugs can cause impulse and mood disorders. They are associated with higher level of impulse control disorder and mood and behavioral disorders. So we need to avoid those drugs because already, as I showed in the paper which I presented, there is a almost 40 to 50% increase in the mood disorders and non-motor Parkinson's symptoms, namely mood, anxiety, sleep, behavior, hallucinations, constipation, and general lethargy, apathy, and fatigue. So these symptoms can be more in your patients, and they may come to you or their physician and they may just complain about it. So we need to avoid these drugs and we should depend more on the levodopa or Sindopa for the treatment, which any physician can little bit adjust the dose according to the patient's need. And usually this is short lasting and they definitely show good improvement after that.
My second question, is there any role of immunoglobulin in neurological complication related with COVID-19?
Yes, so that's a very good question, sir. Thank you for asking that question. As I was mentioning, we are seeing cases of Guillain-Barré syndrome now, or GBS. And as you know very well, the treatment for Guillain-Barré syndrome is, number one is IV immunoglobulins or plasmapheresis. Immunoglobulins is a preferred treatment because it does not have any hemodynamic compromise or bleeding manifestation or other complications. It's a safe treatment, relatively safe treatment. So definitely when a patient with Guillain-Barré syndrome is coming to us, we are sending for COVID RT-PCR. And we are suspecting, because usually this patient will have 2 to 3 weeks a minor sore throat or a diarrhea. Now those both of those symptoms can be because of COVID, and the patient would have healed for 2 weeks, and now he is presenting with a GBS, which is presenting like a weakness of all the folding. So there, the treatment will be immunoglobulins. Second condition where it will be maybe a myasthenia gravis, which is triggered by a fever or a COVID virus infection, there the role of immunoglobulins with an acute myasthenic crisis. These are the two practical indications right now. Apart from this, multiple sclerosis is a stable disease. Usually we don't use immediately. We may use IV solumedrol or methylprednisolone or other medications.
Dr. Vikas.
Thank you.
I have one question.
Yes, sir.
We are treating COVID patients with low molecular weight heparin.
Yes, sir.
So what are the implications on stroke?
Yes, sir.
So cause more hemorrhages?
Yes, sir. So the point is here, as you see the COVID-19 pathogenesis, when it comes to the angiotensin converting enzyme, that receptor modulation is there. Along with that, we, as Dr. Joy was mentioning, there is an increased D-dimer and ferritin level. So COVID-19 per se can predispose a patient to a prothrombotic or a thrombotic state. What is the evidence of that? We have cases where young people who have no comorbidities, no smoking history, are coming with large vessel occlusion. Their internal carotid artery is totally occluded suddenly after a COVID infection. So that gives a clear indication that the virus has triggered a thrombotic state in this patient. In these cases, we have to use low molecular weight heparin. The practical tip will be better to use instead of a conventional heparin, better to use low molecular weight heparin, because it is, as you know from the literature, the risk of bleeding is slightly less. Even though we don't have a converting agent immediately for some of them have, but the safety pattern is very. So our protocol, usually we use it when we think it is a cardioembolic stroke or it is a thrombotic stroke. In those cases, we are using. But as you rightly pointed out, there is a slight increased risk of bleeding, but most of these bleedings are mild to moderate bleeding in the brain. So they can be managed with conservative treatment and stopping antiplatelets and antithrombotic agents for, say, 3 days or 5 days, and then restarting aspirin again after, say, 5 days. So conservative treatment in most of these cases will manage. So that fear should not stop us from treating these patients, because this drug can be life-saving for the patient.
Dr. Vikas Agarwal, yes, sir. Yes, one sir. Question yes, from sir. My side. What the cause of seizure in what the cause of seizure in COVID infection, and yes, what the prognosis?
Yes, I think some call is coming. Okay, so the prognosis of seizure is very good in COVID-19 infection. As I said, a new onset seizure in a patient of COVID is usually can be simply because of the inflammatory response to the COVID. For example, like any other infection, you have a sepsis in a medical ICU. You have a sepsis. The patient can have a septic encephalopathy and can throw a seizure. That doesn't mean that the brain is primarily affected or brain is primarily damaged. So it can just be a irritative or a seizurogenic response to the virus, which can be easily managed with simple medicines like levetiracetam or lacosamide. So these are the two drugs which we usually have. Levipil, you must be knowing, Levipil and lacosamide. These are the two common drugs which we use nowadays. And most of the patients do very well. Even patients who are coming with status, they are coming out. Yesterday also, I admitted an acute encephalitis with the status epilepticus. And within 24 hours by today, the patient has come out of the status and patient has become conscious. I loaded the patient with levetiracetam 1 gram, and along with the meningitis treatment, we did not do any imaging except for a CT brain. Clinical diagnosis was done with the help of a neck rigidity, which I examined using the gloves and other protective equipment, confirmed it is clinical meningitis, and treated the patient with the meropenem and ceftriaxone and Fitz medicine, and patient is fine within 12 hours. So what I'm trying to say is that we need not rely much in a non-COVID situation in a corporate hospital. I will never do that. I will always ask for an MRI brain with contrast, and then I will start the treatment. I will rule out other causes. But now the scenario is changed. We have to judiciously use the investigation and rely on our basic MBBS teaching and learning, which we have learned from our gurus.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir.
May I ask one question from Dr. Varghese?
Yes.
Dr. Varghese is here.
You are muted.
Yes, sir.
May I ask one question from Dr. Varghese?
Yes, sir.
So I have seen many cases. They have high blood sugar levels after treatment. What may be the causes? As high as 500 milligram DL.
After the steroid therapy?
Yes, after the steroid therapy. But I have two cases. just imagine, I have two cases. Both are getting 8 milligram of Madrol, and one have 300 milligram of blood sugar, and another has normal level.
Yeah. If the patient is already on diabetic,
can this Madrol be cited as the culprit?
Because the steroid therapy, we have to give in the ideal scenario, not for the mild COVID. And if you are very sure about the taking the CT scan, choroid score, and the inflammatory markers, if it is high, moderate, then we have to use the steroid therapy. If the patient is already a known diabetic, so we have to give insulin based on the, we have to regularly check the blood sugar level. But if it goes to high, mean if the blood sugar level goes more than 500, that time insulin infusion. But and we have to follow close monitoring. And most of the time, once we are reducing the dosage of the steroid therapy, almost all the patients are easily manageable. So not only this COVID time, even we will use the steroid therapy even for varying indication as the pulse therapy. For example, after liver transplant, they will give you a high dose of steroid and to suppress their immunity. Sometimes rejection happens in the liver. We will give 1 gram pulse therapy for 3 days. So in almost all the scenario, whenever you are going to use the high dose of steroid, there will be a transient rise in the sugar level. But we have to manage that with the insulin chart, the infusion, using the insulin chart.
Sir, I have one apprehension, whether this COVID is causing pancreatitis or affecting the pancreatic functions.
If the virus the virus per se causing the pancreatitis, so as far as my knowledge, the literature says no further publications. But what we are seeing in practice, the high level of the blood sugar after giving the steroid therapy, pulse steroid therapy. So that's why, as I already mentioned, even though patient, not a COVID patient, but already a post-transplant or sometimes, we supposed to give the pulse therapy to reduce the rejection. So that time also, the sugar level will go to more than 500. So it is the steroid-induced the hyperglycemia.
One more question. Hello. One more question.
Yes, sir.
In gastroenteritis caused by COVID-19, we find this COVID nucleoprotein in stool for a pretty longer time. So when to stop medication for this COVID-19 induced gastroenteritis?
If I can answer that question, yeah. We generally don't use any antivirals per se to treat this gastroenteritis. We as such, according to the American College of Gastroenterology guidelines, any viral diarrhea, any diarrhea for that matter, when it begins, we generally give azithromycin to begin with. In India, I understand the concept of giving quinolone and tinidazole or metronidazole is quite rampant, but we don't know that the metronidazole resistance rate is 80%. So if you have to follow the recent guidelines, better to start on azithromycin. But that drug being abused in every center now because it's a part of COVID treatment. And the virus excretion rate is still 5 weeks, according to the last year's literature. This year, we have not reviewed the recent literature. But the excretion of the virus in the stool does not necessarily mean that it's actually infective. It's not transmissible. Even we do procedures when these patients are there. We don't even test because the infectivity rate as such is very less. Because this is an airborne infection, even the droplet infection which can be transmitted by this fecal contamination is very negligible. So we do not treat it. And we don't even test it. Apart from the regular PPE which we use to do a colonoscopy even in infected patients, apart from that, we don't have a heightened sense of alarm in seeing this excretion of virus in stool material. I wouldn't be too cautious about it. It's not that infective. In fact, the quarantine period itself is very less. And a virus excretion rate in stool is still 5 weeks. No specific medicines to treat the virus in stool. And regarding the earlier question, the pancreatitis, even we suspect COVID-related pancreatitis, but no way to prove it. We have seen unexplained pancreatitis in young people for whom there was some episode of fever 1 week ago or something. But generally, the evidence to say that RT-PCR is positive or COVID-PCR test is positive is lacking. That's why I think, as Dr. Pargisar was saying, in the publications, the data is lacking to correlate virus infection with the pancreatitis. That data correlation is wrong.
So, sir,
I wanted to ask because of one question. Like, so many times we have seen this GBS and then post vaccination stroke patients, all COVID tests coming negative, and then retrospectively thinking that it could be COVID infection, whereas the nasal swab RT-PCR positive, COVID CT test negative. Do you think there is a role for studying the CSF for PCR analysis for COVID?
Just to add, sir,
in
moderate to severe COVID, when to switch from oral to IV steroids, and what to do when we have a deranged LFT?
I think, Vishnu, that question is towards you.
No, it's up to me. Okay. As the Dr. Jog was telling, in case of severe LFT abnormalities, the serial derangement of LFT functions, even steroids we use it with caution, then doesn't be used with caution, because steroids per se are going to worsen the GGTP. And the protocol, we follow whatever the Ministry of Health and Family Welfare has given. The guidelines are very clear. I don't know about the other hospitals. The guidelines are pretty clear. In moderate to severe cases, the 5-day steroid course is there. Different hospitals use different steroid therapy, but as long as the patient is getting admitted in the hospital, the steroid of choice is methylprednisolone. And the tapering dose of choice is dexamethasone. And generally, it is not being given beyond 5 weeks. And when do we give it? It is to control the cytokine milieu. It is to control the inflammation. So in second week, once the viral replicative phase is over, if we think the inflammatory milieu is cascading, it is not coming down, if the dust is not settling down, then the choice of treatment is for 3 to 5 days, beyond which we do not continue, I think.
And then, what are the prognostic implications of diarrhea in COVID-19? Prognostic implications.
None. Just avoid the dehydration. Just hydrate them well. There is no such thing like last year when we used to say if the patient has anosmia, loss of taste, it's most probably a mild case. Likewise, we don't have a say that if the patient comes to just a GI manifestation, only diarrhea, it may not be necessarily a mild case scenario, because we have seen the patient initially coming with diarrhea, we send them home, and 10th day they come up as an ICU case, gasping for breath. So prognostic implication is as such not there, not correlated. Only thing which can correlate is studying the inflammatory markers side by side, which we do not do unless otherwise the patient is very sick.
So to answer Dr. Vishnu's question on that CSF, no, which he asked, shall I answer that?
Yeah, please, sir.
Yeah. So we have to understand that the neurological manifestation in COVID-19 infections are not direct infections. Many of these symptoms are because of indirect mechanisms. So like when we talk about CSF-PCR positivity, it indicates that the viral load in the CSF has to be high. But even in a routine GBS, that is not the case. We don't demonstrate any active viral infection there. So except for acute viral myelitis, we may get some HTLV PCR positivity there. So the point is that CSF PCR may not be very useful. In fact, in one of the studies, it was shown that the patient had neurological manifestations, but the CSF PCR was negative or normal. So it may not be very useful. Second point, a practical point is that we in fact wanted to do for one of our GBS patients just for academic reasons, but it was not available. So they cannot sample it from the CSF, they said, you know. So that may be another problem with it. But overall, it's not required because it's not a direct mechanism. We may not be able to demonstrate the viral load in the even a negligible viral load in the CSF, because the inflammation can be indirect, which is causing GBS, or it's mainly an autoantibody related mechanism. So maybe that is the answer to your question.
Thank you, sir. Shall we move up to the next session, next talk, sir? So now I request Dr. Siddhika Iyer. She is Secretary at Gleneagles Hospital for a very interesting and important talk that we all doctors and all patients are suffering, how to handle the psychological impact of COVID-19. Dr. Siddhika, please. Please unmute.
Thank you so much. Wishing all of you a very good evening. And two wonderful presentations, I must say, I really enjoyed and learned a lot. Can you see my presentation?
Yes, please. Yeah. Please. Please start.
Yes. So basically, I'm going to be discussing about the psychological impact of the COVID-19 pandemic. So now when we talk about psychological, we talk about what a person is feeling emotionally, any behavior changes that are seen in a person, and also the thought process of the person. Is there any overthinking, any stressful thoughts, any anxiety which is there in the person? So I am Dr. Siddhika Iyer. I practice at Gleneagles Global Health City as a consultant psychiatrist. So as you all know, the emotions that we are experiencing right now are extremely overwhelming and challenging for the general public as well as for the doctors and the healthcare workers. So we are experiencing a range of emotions, which goes from anxiety and fear about, which started as what is the meaning of pandemic and what is the meaning of COVID-19, coming now to anxiety and fear about how am I going to manage if I have the illness, will I get a bed, will I get oxygen, you know, the whole country is kind of scrambling for knowing what to do if somebody in their family or they themselves get infected. And an anxiety now which comes up about, should I get a vaccination or not? Which vaccine should I get? And where will I get my vaccination? Why am I not getting any slots? So right from the implications of the pandemic to the vaccine, we are seeing a range of emotions. We also see that, you know, because of the effects of the lockdown, because of the illness itself, because of somebody in the family suffering from COVID-19, people become depressed, they feel lonely. Some people may feel guilty. There is a general feeling of helplessness and anger as to why is this happening to us. There is a feeling of hopelessness, as in when is this going to get over and is it going to get over or not? And especially among the healthcare community, there's a general sense of frustration, feeling of tiredness, and a sense of impending burnout that, you know, we cannot handle this anymore and we want to go back to our normal duties, the things that we normally do. So the second wave actually kind of completely hit us at a time when there was hope that the first wave is over and the pandemic was over. So even though last year in 2020, we were taken aback, it was like a shock for us. We had to kind of adapt what we were doing, work in PPE, we had to start doing teleconsultation and basically change our way of practicing. And so there was a sense that, okay, is it over? And also, you know, is the vaccine is going to be the reason why it is going to be over. But and just as we were recovering from the effects of the first wave, we were hit with the second wave. So not only because of the numbers and because of the extensive infection that we are seeing and the extensive numbers that we are seeing of the second wave, we have not had time to recover from the effects of the first wave. So I'm going to be discussing with the following points, that is, first is what are we seeing in patients diagnosed as COVID positive in terms of psychiatric manifestations? In patients who are hospitalized, what are we seeing? In patients who have recovered from COVID, what are they presenting with, the general impact on the general population, and the impact on medical staff and frontline workers, and finally, a few points about how to take care of our mental health. So starting with in patients diagnosed as a COVID positive, we are generally seeing that, you know, when patients start having symptoms, there is an anxiety about hospitalization, about quarantine, sometimes to the effect that they may delay the diagnosis because they don't approach a doctor or don't go to the hospital fast enough. Once a patient is quarantined, it may be that the person is very bored, very restless, and feels depressed, lonely, and isolated at home. There may be a sense of having overwhelming negative thoughts because there's nothing to do if they are quarantined. And there's a sense that what is going to happen now? Is it going to become worse? Especially with the constant news that we are getting and the constant contact with social media that we have, there is a fear that symptoms will increase. And because of that, patients often Google their symptoms and the treatment. And we often see that patients come up to doctors and say, you know, can I take this? Can I take this medicine? Am I being treated enough? Should I be taking anything else? And we know now also because people have been advised to keep pulse oximeters at home and they have learned how to use them. There is a constant checking of what their vitals are and what their saturation levels are. To an extent that people may also, you know, check in all their fingers, in both their hands and say, you know, it's very difficult for a lay person to understand that there is going to be a normal diurnal variation. There is going to be differences in their saturation levels on a minute-to-minute basis. And that causes an increase in anxiety because they don't completely understand that. And we also see that, you know, people start following excessive home remedies. And this can actually lead to some of the problems which probably Dr. Vishnu has seen. One of the patients that we have seen, you know, we have an Ayurvedic preparation in South India, which is called as Kabasura Kudinir. So a patient actually thought that he does not want the disease to become too much. And so he started having Kabasura Kudinir for 21 days. He had it on empty stomach. I don't know what is the magical number 21, but I ended up having a lot of gastritis and distress. He actually had to then take medication. And so the initial cause being that the anxiety was not going away. He was constantly thinking about, you know, am I going to die? What is going to happen to me? So we had to then treat him for the anxiety following the treatment for the gastritis. Now, in hospitalized patients, we do find it like, you know, insomnia is one of the most common things that we are seeing. And it is also expected because, you know, in a new place, anxiety because of the symptoms which are present and constant monitoring, which may be present, especially in the ICU, patients are finding it difficult to sleep, difficult to rest. And when they don't, when they are not able to sleep, comes a constant flow of thoughts about, you know, what are we doing here and what is going to happen now. So it is also difficult to manage the insomnia because we don't want to give too many sedative medication, which may cause a decrease in the saturation. So it's basically like a balance we have to keep between managing the insomnia and maintaining the saturation levels. We do find that giving melatonin is quite good to manage these patients as well. The second problem that we face is patients who are agitated and uncooperative for treatment. As we know that, you know, patients do have this happy hypoxia where their saturation levels drop, but they do not have any subjective symptoms. They do not feel that they are dyspneic or breathless. So in that case, they do not understand why am I getting treated and what is the need for hospitalization. So in such situations, it is possible that the patient may get agitated and may be uncooperative for taking medication. again, in hospitalized patients, it's very common that we find that they want to get out of the hospital, they want to get out of the ICU, they can get depressed, they can feel lonely. And we do find that regular counseling and teleconsultation helps them, as well as keeping in touch with their family members through video calls does help them. One of the problems that we are facing is an anxiety about what is the O2 saturation like, and a subjective feeling of breathlessness when a patient is being weaned off the ventilator. So we may find that the patient is completely maintaining his saturation levels, can be weaned off a ventilator, can be weaned off oxygen, but the patient is anxious, and when at the time of weaning off, they start hyperventilating. So then again, it causes fluctuation in their saturation levels, and they may feel very restless. They may not want to get out of the oxygen. So in such cases, we do find that teaching them relaxation techniques and deep breathing exercises really helps. Sitting in the ICU, patients often think about what is the worst possible thing that can happen to them. They worry about their family, and they also start thinking about what they have not done in their life. They start thinking about what all are they regretting in their life. And this can actually make them more depressed. This can actually make them feel low, and to the point of actually feel like giving up. So it's important here that we need to motivate them and, you know, try to keep them positive so that they are fighting. The worst possible thing actually that we have come across is, you know, losing a loved one when a person is admitted in the hospital. So here they are unable to mourn that loss. They are unable to have family with them. They cannot actually understand, fully comprehend what is happening. And here, even we are actually kind of at a loss as to, you know, how can we console them? The only thing that we can actually do is, you know, be frank with them, let them share whatever experiences they have, and, you know, let them vent out what they are feeling. It could be like a sense of denial. No, you are lying to me. This has not happened. It could be an anger. You did not do enough to save him. That kind of thing. It could be sudden breakdown, crying all the time, refusing to eat food. And this also we have to start managing. And then we have to slowly bring them towards a level of accepting and taking care of their health, because they also would have dependents who are relying on them to come out of the hospital. And after recovery from COVID, we do find that insomnia persists. And it can be very disturbing, very anxiety provoking, and very annoying actually that, you know, I am all right now and I just want to rest, but I am just not able to sleep. Sometimes a patient may not have had insomnia, but then may develop it later on. There may be nightmares. There may be feeling of palpitations. Patients are waking up in the middle of the night, having palpitations, breathlessness, gasping for air. You know, one of our patients actually just got up with a panic attack and ran out of her house, because the whole sense of being quarantined for that long, it just gives a sense of being trapped. So they want to be free. Again, a subjective sense of breathlessness where the saturation levels are maintained, but causing anxiety so that the patient constantly checks what is the saturation. Like, we do see steroid-induced psychosis, and this will be needed to manage. Will be needed to be managed with antipsychotics and mood stabilizers. There can be also, we see that there is a persisting fear of infecting the family, especially children. So we had a patient who got affected with COVID 2 months after her delivery, postpartum. And she, after discharge, we were expecting, okay, that, you know, she has to now bond with her child because she has lost about almost a month during the hospitalization. But we realized that the family was actually making plans so that the patient would be in a separate room and the child would be in a separate room because of the fear that she may still be infective and she may still transmit the infection to her child. So these kind of misinformation is present, and it is very important for us to, you know, identify them, because especially since this is actually a time where the mother has to bond with the child, and they would be missing out if we did not communicate it properly to them that she can absolutely be with the child all the time. There is a difficulty getting back to their usual routine work. And we do see that there is a persistent fatigue which is present for a long time after the infection. So the fatigue gives rise to a restlessness, a frustration that, you know, when can I do my work normally? Why is this affecting me so much? And a comparison that other people are, you know, doing so well. Other people are utilizing lockdown for positive stuff. And I have to be stuck here. I am not progressing in my life. So after recovery, we often see that there is a sense of hurry to complete one's life duties. Like one of our patients, she was suffering from COVID-19, but she was home quarantined. But after she got better, there was a sense that my daughter has to be married now, fast as possible, because I could have died. And then, you know, I would not have fulfilled that responsibility. So it's very important that we realize also that these things may be going on in a patient's mind, which we don't often think of. We often think that, you know, they should just be happy that they are well, or, you know, they should just be thankful that they have recovered. They did not need hospitalization. But often we find that patients are actually having very varied thoughts, varied problems, which we may not even anticipate unless, you know, they share these things to us. In the general population, there is a general feeling of anxiety, of fear about when is this going to end? Why is the lockdown necessary? And I do have a lot of people coming up, and since we are starting our lockdown tomorrow, who will suddenly say, you know, I'm feeling trapped. I don't know what to do. And what about the economic loss that people are facing? In addition to that, they have the anxiety of, will I be affected? And when can I start living my normal life? Again, as I told you before, it will be like this time with the second wave is, am I going to be safe? Am I going to get a bed? Am I going to get oxygen? Now, all these words like remdesivir and treatment modalities, plasma therapy, ECMO, everything has become a household name. So everybody has half knowledge about it and is constantly cooking something in their head about it. There's a great sense of, you know, dysphoria or, and, you know, feeling uncomfortable if patients lose their sense of smell. And it is very distressing for the patient. And also in anticipation, you know, many of our patients constantly are checking, you know, by applying some kind of deodorant or, you know, smelling their coffee and saying, am I able to smell it or not? Do you think I'm just checking every day whether I have COVID by seeing whether I can smell this? And even if they have minor symptoms like sometimes palpitations, a sense of breathlessness, fearing that are these symptoms of COVID, they rush to the emergency room, they rush to the infectious disease specialist, and they frankly have no time to deal with anxiety. So it is basically burdening our system because these patients have these anxieties. Again, as we discussed about taking the vaccination and when will I get the vaccination, also is a source of anxiety for a lot of people. So over the last year, we have seen increased stress because of working from home, because of associated financial problems, because of loss in the job. We have seen increased alcohol use, cigarette smoking, and increased drug use. During the lockdown, again, we see patients who have a lot of withdrawal symptoms because they suddenly don't get alcohol anymore. We have something called behavior addictions, which is increased in gaming, use of the mobile phone, increase in use of Netflix, Amazon Prime, like binge watching series. And we have eating disorders, like either patients are not eating at all because they don't have a routine. So they get up very late, sleep very late. don't have a good routine to follow when to sleep, when to eat, when to do their work. And on the other hand, we do also like associated with watching binge watching series, they also have binge eating. And so they would be eating very not a good healthy diet. We unfortunately have been seeing a lot of increased domestic violence and marital discord. So underlying, conflict between a husband and wife, which may have been ignored for many years because they are working, because they don't talk about it, suddenly comes up when, you put two people inside the same house for such a long time. The worst affected definitely are children. Children thrive on meeting other kids, playing with them. So this social isolation has been almost the worst on them and their development. Children have a difficulty in concentration, even though they have tried to pick up with the digital learning, but it's been very difficult for their attention span. Children cannot express their feelings like adults. So we often see it in terms of mood swings, aggressive episodes, or refusal to eat, refusal to study, refusal to turn on the laptop in order to attend school. Children are being exposed to a very tense family atmosphere. So if people at home are constantly watching the news or keeping updates about how many cases, how many deaths, children are exposed to this news every day. And we find that, sometimes the child has to take care of the parent when the parent is isolated, when the parent has symptoms. And so that is so much responsibility on a small child. And so children also are thinking, is my family getting proper treatment? They have to take the responsibility of going to the doctor, following up. We do know that we will never know actually the extent how much it's affecting our children, the pandemic, till it gets over. And then we'll have to, probably incorporate counseling or therapy in schools to actually undo the damage this is causing. So during the first wave, everybody was talking about how COVID-19 has exacerbated India's hidden mental health pandemic. And before we had time to expose this hidden mental health pandemic, we've been hit with another trauma here. So, we can only anticipate there's going to be a lot of post-traumatic stress disorder, depressive disorders, anxiety disorders, increase in obsessive-compulsive disorders, increase in violence and this marital discord. Addictions, as we have discussed, which we will be probably be able to diagnose and get to once the lockdown is over and once the pandemic is over. So what can we do in terms of helping our patients with their mental health? So one thing which is really the truth is that there is a lot of stigma about taking help for mental health issues and taking treatment for psychiatric issues. So as doctors, we have to work towards ending the stigma that patients feel. We have to increase the awareness that mental health treatment is available and it is not wrong to take the treatment and it is not going to affect the patient in any negative way. We need to encourage adequate treatment of psychiatric symptoms, whether it is with medication, therapy, or support groups. This could be the COVID-induced symptoms, and it could also just be the underlying psychiatric problems that we are observing because of the pandemic. So as a frontline worker, we know that it is of utmost importance that we have to take care of ourselves before we can take care of others. But we also know that many of the frontline workers, especially the medical staff, ignore this. So I would like to take this opportunity to thank all of you, for your wonderful services during this pandemic. And everyone in their own right is a warrior. So think of yourself in that way, that you are a warrior. And why? What is it that makes me a warrior? Is that, you have been working and adapting through these really tough times. You have been doing the best you can considering all these circumstances. You have been motivating your colleagues and taking care of them. You have been grieving for your family, friends, and colleagues. And we know that for doctors and medical staff, it has really hit home, where we know so many people who have been suffering and who have passed away because of COVID. We have been educating others and, you know, using such webinars to actually improve our knowledge, keep ourselves updated, and to learn something new every day. The emotional toll that it has taken on the healthcare workers is that they are physically tired, they are emotionally exhausted, tending towards going to a burnout. There has been no time to process their emotions. They feel overwhelmed and helpless and angry at the situation. They also feel guilt that I have not been able to do enough. I have not been able to save this patient. And we are seeing a condition called as compassion fatigue, where a person is suddenly feeling numb, not able to understand, not able to grieve. Suddenly it is becoming like normal hearing a very negative statistic, or trying to think too much in terms of statistics and not able to process the emotion of how this is affecting them. And this is what we are calling as compassion fatigue, that you are tired to show that emotion. There is a difficulty in concentration and focusing at work, especially among the nursing staff. And we know that they do need to be concentrating, they do need to be focusing. And for that, they do need to have adequate rest. So what can we do to stay calm, to build our resilience, and to continue our work when, you know, a small thing like just watching the news can trigger so much of negativity in us? So taking care of our mental health is very similar to taking care of our physical health. So a very basic tenet that we have is eating healthy, making sure that you're not skipping meals, whatever your duty timings are, making sure that you're not binge eating, making sure that you're not stress eating. Exercise and relaxation. We know that medical staff and doctors may not have time to exercise, may not have time to do the relaxation, but you know, it is very important to get that time to do a little bit so that we are able to take care of our health. You know, as Dr. Shivshankar said in the middle, said in the beginning, that he attended the musical night. So it is so important that, you know, we keep motivating ourselves and others by doing small things like this relaxation so that we feel better and we are able to go on. Having a sense of awareness and being mindful of ourselves so that we can focus on good choices and intentions. I'll explain this a little bit more in the next slide. Staying connected with our loved ones, with our family and friends. You know, we see this often that after you finish work at the hospital, a person just wants to go and may not talk to their family because all they have is negative stories, or all they have is something very bad which happened at work. But it's important to have that social connection, to feel that sense of love and connection with your close people to take care of your mental health. And lastly, it is sleep. You know, everybody's need for sleep is different. It may be 6 to 8 hours, and it is very difficult if you are anxious to get that sleep. So it is important, like, you know, this is a very simple acronym called HEALS. And if you follow this, then you will be able to take care of not only your physical health, but also your mental health. So just to explain, being mindful doesn't mean that we are like Buddha, where nothing is affecting us. And because even Buddha has to wear a mask in these times. But it basically is that we have to be able to accept that this is a stressful and tough time for everyone. And being emotionally vulnerable in this time does not mean that one is weak. So feeling stressed, feeling anxious or frustrated is a normal response. So the first step is accepting the emotions that you are feeling. taking time to understand these emotions and to process them. And then finally, to be able to express it in some way or the other. You know, some people may be writing about it. Some people may be sharing with a friend. Some people may talk to a therapist. So expressing it, sharing it, talking about what is happening and what you are feeling, what you are going through, helps you vent it out. It doesn't remain a part of your body anymore, and you are able to process it from the outside. Everyone takes their own time to process changes and copes differently. So if one person is running every day, or if one person is cooking to relax, it doesn't mean you have to do the same thing. So learn what works for you and take time to unwind and relax without a sense of guilt. You know, my patient is dying, my patient is not well, my colleague is working, my colleague has COVID. So how can I relax? How can I unwind? How can I take care of myself? So this guilt, which is there, it doesn't help us in the long run. So even if we do feel guilty, we need to know that I have to take care of myself, I have to take care of others. And so take time to unwind and relax without that guilt. So basically the 3 hours, getting rest, getting some relaxation, and reaching out if you feel like. So basically we can only take one day at a time. So worrying about the future doesn't really help us. And we have to remember that this too shall pass. And hopefully together, we will get through this. So I'm hoping for a new sunrise soon without the pandemic. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Deepika, for a wonderful, wonderful talk, need of the time. Just seeing that the patient, when they counsel us this, the first question that comes, will I die? Will I survive? So psychological part is very important. We have seen couples loving together in the pandemic and fighting a lot also. So it's very important to give time to your family, to your kids, do some exercise, do some musical part. Thank you, Dr. Siddhika. Any questions from the panel?
Siddhika, good evening. That's a fantastic presentation. You covered extensively. One thing I wanted to ask was, do you get cases of any of this? Relatives and attenders of these COVID patients lining up to you, seeking any help, how to deal with this situation? Or is there any light at the end of the tunnel for these patients?
Yeah, we do see relatives, you know, of the patient coming up and saying, you know, like they actually don't know how to handle the situation. And, you know, it's basically like, for a long time, I think people felt that if there has been a positive diagnosis, then, you know, we cannot tell anyone about it. So they would hide it from their family. They would hide it from even their apartment, where actually they're supposed to disclose things. So it was basically something inside that they cannot come up and actually talk to anybody about it. So they would, and again, you know, we see relatives of patients also having similar kind of symptoms and suddenly also thinking about, do I have COVID symptoms as well? So that kind of thing as well. And of course, we do see relatives regularly if they have lost someone due to COVID. So as a general part of counseling, as a general part of helping them through the grief process, we do see such patients as well.
So any hand in pharmacotherapy in any of the post-COVID patients who have come to you with anxiety or depression or health anxiety, any sort of things, or no role of pharmacotherapy there?
Of course there is a role of pharmacotherapy because, you know, sometimes they are not in the kind of mind space to actually understand counseling. It's just because the physical symptoms are they persist for a long time. So especially for insomnia, we do give melatonin or, you know, clonazepam. And if there is anxiety and depressive symptoms, we do use antidepressants like SSRIs, escitalopram, or desvenlafaxine. We are using these drugs.
Thank you.
What should be the dose and duration of such type of drugs? like antidepressive drugs or anti-anxiety drugs? What should be the proper dose and duration?
Basically, usually we start off with a low dose to see, and then we up-titrate the medication. So say, for example, we are giving escitalopram. We would start off with 5 milligram and increase it slowly till the patient has a response, maybe up to 20 to 30 milligram. And we give the medication depending on, like, you know, because it's a post-COVID situation, the stressor is probably having COVID, or a person he knows having COVID. So in this case, if the stressor goes away, the symptoms are likely to go away. In that time, we suggest a period of about 3 to 6 months where the patient can take the medication. And if there has been underlying stressors which are coming out, and that is why the patient has been, is coming to us, then probably the patient requires treatment for a longer time. Basically depends on what is the diagnosis, how severe it is, and the patient's response to the therapy.
Is there any risk of drug dependency?
There is no risk of drug dependency with antidepressants. There is a risk of drug dependency with benzodiazepines. So benzodiazepines would be a very short course till the anxiety alleviates, till the physical symptoms come down. So that would just be, we would start maybe clonazepam and then taper the dose and then stop the medication, maybe say in 1 month's time. But apart from that, for antidepressants, there is no fear of drug dependency.
Okay, sir, any more questions from the panel? So, taking care of the time, so now we are moving to the last talk of the day. I invite Dr. Vandana Tanwar, Chairperson, Physician, ex-India Team Physio Olympics, for a talk on self-rehab for quarantine patients in the COVID. Dr. Vandana, please. Please unmute yourself.
Is it visible?
Yes, you can see the slides.
Very good evening to all of you. I'm really honored to be a part of this IOA. It's really a pleasure for me to meet you all here. And Dr. Siddhika has well explained about the role of how mindful and how the psychopath really plays an important role for the COVID patients. So now I myself, Dr. Vandana Tanwar, a chairperson of Physiolution, wants to represent you the self-rehabilitation for quarantine COVID patients today. So now it's fitness is now, it's a high time to educate our people around about the role of fitness in our daily lifestyle, whether it's a normal population or even we paramedics and the doctors here, we're really struggling hard to save the lives of our patients. So active living is something which is now very, very crucial. We need to be active. We need to get some time out of our busy schedules, even who are still going to the hospitals or the clinics and seeing the patients. So we need to be active in our lifestyle, which has parameters of the wellness, which is emotional, as Dr. Siddhika has explained this part, the physical, social, environmental, spiritual, and your mental. So these are the parameters where you stand and all these things revolves around you and how you take this situation. So in this pandemic situation of COVID, we really need to educate people, because if you ask like, okay, you are self-quarantined, then what will you do? So the sedentary behavior and the low levels of physical activity, how it can impact their health, their well-being. So it is affecting actually the quality of the life of the individuals. So it can cause additional stresses, anxiety level, and the, of course, insomnia. In various parameters, it is affecting the health of our citizens. So in this time, the physical activity and relaxation techniques are really valuable tool, which really adds up and help in the recovery from the COVID. So even the WHO recommends that the 150 minutes of moderate intensity or the 75 minutes of vigorous intensity physical activity per week can be done, but this is for the non-COVID. So what about the COVID patients, how they will gonna deal with it? So first we need to educate them that if they think that just the isolation, stop talking to the people will help them, no. If they are quarantined, they are isolated from their own family members, then they have to do something which keeps them moving, which keeps their oxygen level high. Because as so many doctors have already explained, the other factors like obesity, the cardiovascular things, you know, how they are affecting the lives of the COVID patients and how they are increasing the risk factors for the COVID patients. So we need to tell them the benefits of the physical activity, that it actually helps in maintaining their healthy weight. It reduces the feelings of their anxiety, depression. It keeps their bones, muscle, joints healthy. And of course, it improves the quality of sleep and improves their energy level as well. So the people who are even the risk or the dying from the heart disease or the stroke or the BP, cholesterol, diabetes, osteoporosis. So they, we need to educate them that apart from the COVID, if you have certain other hypertension and other relevant disease, then you really need to exercise to improve your other vital functions so that you can maintain your lipid profile, your glucose control, you can decrease the anxiety and depression. So I will show you some quickly the exercises here.
Volume is not coming. Dr. Vandana, please increase volume of the video. Volume is not coming. Please check for the volume bar. Or you can speak in the background. You can talk from here in the background.
Okay. So I'm just telling the exercises here that you can see what I'm doing. Can you hear?
Yes, yes.
Okay.
Please continue.
Dr. Vandana, we are not able to hear the audio from the video.
Yeah, audio. Yes. Okay, you're not able to hear the audio. Okay, okay.
No,
we are
not.
Okay, so what I'm doing here, I'm just taking the deep breath, filling, you can say that I'm just filling up my lungs and then exhaling from the nose and with the movements of the hand, because with the hand movements, I'm just you can see the expansion of your pectoral region, the chest expansion. So it improves the air flow to your more chest expansion means more air flow. This is what I'm saying here. So I'm just showing the stretches and the breathing pattern, how you need to do it. So all the doctors can perform this even at their practice parts, even the hospitals, they can do these part whenever they get time. So now in this video, I'm inhaling from the nose and I'm exhaling from the mouth. So I'm again stretching, inhaling for 10 seconds and exhaling again for 10 seconds. So these are the ways how we can breathe. These are the relaxation technique which is really needed nowadays. So now the exercises will come up with the sitting position. So we need to practice the yoga for our mind control. We need to do a lot of meditation nowadays because it is a relaxation technique. And we need to improve our oxygen level in our body. So here you can see the spine has to be erect. You need to maintain this mudra. So in this, you just have to quickly inhale and quickly exhale. So when we are exhaling, our muscles are getting contraction. So even our lungs become strong. So you can see when we inhale quickly and exhale quickly. So this is a kind of training what we need to do with our muscles, our diaphragmatic movements. You can practice this yoga mudra for say 20 seconds and you can do it 5 times. Now, this is another yoga mudra, which is a pranayama, where you have to inhale from one side of your nose and then exhaling. So this video can be watched at my channel Physiolution with the audio also. So I'm inhaling, but now exhaling. Inhaling. This is very important yoga, which we all need to do. We all doctors need to do this. So anybody can do it, like who is quarantined for some time. So they can rejuvenate themselves with such kind of physical activity. They need to keep their spine erect while doing these mudras and stretching part. So after watching this video, you must have realized that the mindfulness and the relaxation therapy plays a very vital role in our daily lives. So in physical fitness, what you can do, like the people who are quarantined, they are in just room. So what they can do, they can just do, like if they are sitting over their chair, they can just get up from the chair, then sit down, then get up, then sit down. This can be done with the even the cases who are higher on the obesity side. They can't do much endurance. And the people who are at the risk of heart problems, they are also like advised not to do much of the, you know, the endurance part, but they're slow movements with their arm movements, circling the movements, doing little bit lunges and adding resistance training, like with the help of TheraBands, they can always do such small exercises, which is already listed in my YouTube channel, Physiolution. So in this pandemic, we really need to motivate. So what is motivation? Motivation is nothing, but it is your own internal drive to accomplish a particular goal. So if the COVID patient has realized this, yes, now I'm infected. So what now? What is my next role? I need to motivate myself so that my family members should be healthy enough, you know, so that I can improve on my vitals. And how it will be done? By keeping his mind cool, he's doing the relaxation therapy, yoga therapy, keeping others happy, yes, on the video calls, on the watching movies and listening to the music. These are the other rejuvenating methods, how they can keep it cool at the quarantine period. And this is what the motivation, what makes people want to work on. So what I say, believe, anything is possible for the COVID patient. They don't need to panic. They just need to relax and they need to understand the only reason, you can see the slide, the only reason the bubble bee cannot, they can fly is because no one told him that he can't. So we all have to realize that even if we are infected, we are quarantined, but yes, quickly we will be recovered if we set some goals that how step by step we have to go ahead. And as I'm a sports physio, I would like to say that we need to stay fit to play sports. People say, I just play badminton, I just play table tennis because I want to stay fit. No, you need to be fit to play sports. So same with our doctors, we need to be very, very much fit so that we can handle our patients more confidently from the while tackling their emotional factor, which is now very relevant as many doctors have already explained that they are panicking. So thank you. It's a teamwork. So let's work in a team. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Dr. Deepak Vandana, for a wonderful demonstration of exercises and motivation. Motivation is really needed in these times. We need motivation. We need to calm down. We need to meditate. Music. Yes.
We need to be in spirit, you know, we need to be spirit. A lot of many things has been discussed about the medical part. So I think fitness is something which brings, you know, energy, quick energy inside you. So all the doctors, whosoever is present here, I would really recommend that please find some time for the online fitness sessions also, apart from these webinars of medical based, you know, just relax your mind also.
Exactly. Because when you're home, we don't know what to do. Thank you. Thanks again.
So thank you so much, all of you.
And hope all our doctors and patients will consult. We'll have a teleconsultation with you. I think Dr. Praveen is sleeping. Please unmute, sir. Praveen, sir, please unmute. Any input from your side?
I really enjoyed all these sessions, almost all the session. And I was not knowing many things regarding COVID, and I came to know so many things. Like neuro manifestation, like GIT manifestation, like psychological manifestation. And I think it will help us in doing practice and in our day-to-day life also. Thank you. Very wonderful speakers today's team.
Thank you, sir. Thanks a lot, sir. Since it's already late. So with this, we'll be ending. I'll request if you have our secretary, Dr. Navin Khattar, sir, here.
Yes, Dr. Hoda.
Sir, Madhusudan, sir.
Dr. Hoda, I'm here.
Yes, Madhusudan, sir, please, sir.
Thanks, Dr. Hoda. Today's program was really very informative and educating. I thanks to our respected President IOA, Secretary IOA, President BOA, and guest speakers, panelists, moderators, all the members of BOA, all the audience, and Ortho TV, especially the Dr. Shamsul Huda, who is the IT convener of the BOA. You all have given the very valuable time and makes this program grand success. Also, in this time of the pandemic, spread positivity. Stay safe, stay home, and help each other as maximum as possible. Thank you. Thank you, everyone. Good night.
Sir, sir.
Thank you to you all. In such a pandemic, it's wonderful that regular webinars are being conducted in association with IOA and BOA. I must thank all the speakers for the knowledge which they shared and have updated us. I'm grateful to the panelists who, despite of their busy schedule, took out time to participate in the webinar. A special thanks to Ortho TV for their constant effort and keeping us updated. I appeal all the delegates to follow the COVID protocol and stay safe. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Manoj, sir, any words from your side, sir? Please unmute, sir.
Thank you, Dr. Shamsul, for inviting us here. And this was a wonderful session, very informative. And the speakers and the faculties were excellent. excellent program and wish that you will continue with such programs. Thank you and good night.
Thank you, sir. Raju Anand, sir, are you here, sir? Raju Anand, sir, Navin Thakkar, sir, I think they are busy. So any last from our panelists, thank you all of you. Any words you'd like to say to the audience, to the doctors, Dr. Joy, Dr. Vikas, Dr. Vishnu, Dr. Siddhika, Dr. Vandana.
Thank you so much, BOA and IOA, for giving us this opportunity. And I think the word is very clear. Stay safe, stay positive, stay healthy. That is what we have to do. We have limitations. Whatever best we can do, we should do. But at the same time, we should also protect ourselves, that we should not land up into some medical legal issues and some other issues which we can avoid. So that is, I think, we should be careful about.
Yeah, that is very important actually, because this is also a disclaimer from Ortho TV to all of the audience, especially that this is a general advisory, not a patient specific treatment. So all the patient must discuss with their specific physicians
for concerned doctors.
Concerned doctors, that is very important actually. Thank you, sir. Thanks to everybody, sir, for coming here, for giving your precious time.
Thanks for having me.
Thank you. Good night. Thanks. Good night,
thank
everybody.
You. Please take good care night. And stay safe.
Bye.
Bye-bye.
Bye to all of you.
Good night. Bye.
Bye. Good night, everyone. Bye.